session. I'm glad that you could come tonight. This is the third in a series of four part series on Africa. Some of you may have been with me for the North Africa session, what was on the 19th of September. And then if you'd like to sign in and take your materials, we'd love to have you. Part two was East Africa. That was on the 17th of October. And tonight we're doing South Africa, the southern regions, countries, for example, like Zambia and Rhodesia, or now called Zimbabwe, of course, South Africa, and Bechuanaland, or what's now called Botswana. We'll be getting into that. Next time, I'll be back here on the 21st, just before Thanksgiving, to do the fourth in the series, which will deal with West Africa, the countries like Nigeria and Ghana and Liberia and Senegal in this region of the continent. That'll be the fourth of the series that'll be coming up on the 21st. I'm very glad that you've come tonight. We have quite a bit to show you and tell you about. I brought also this wonderful hat. This is an actual hat. You like that? you can take a shot if you'd like, okay? We have Ken here, who's our ace videographer from Bedford Television. That's it, wave to hand. Hey, I wanted to show you this hat. This actually comes from the Ndebele people. The Ndebele people in Zimbabwe are cattle herders. They have cattle. And they make their hats and so forth because of the sun, something like a sombrero or a cowboy hat that you're used to seeing in the American Southwest. But they make them all handmade with the leather and the raffia that's inside of it. So I thought I'd show this to you. I'll pass it around so you can get a good look at it. It's really quite an unusual piece. And that was given to me by a visitor that I had to my class. Let me introduce myself. I'm Professor John Kienzle. Some of you have been with me before. I have my bachelor's degree from the State University of New York at Albany, my master's degree from NYU, New York University in New York City, and my PhD from Princeton University. I was a high school teacher. I taught world history for 36 years. And during that time, it was my policy to have people come in to my classroom to meet with my students who came from other places. I would call up the International Student Center at the local university and say, hey, who have you got from Zimbabwe? Do you have someone from Ghana or Nigeria or Kenya? And so whenever that occurred, I was able to bring them in. And many times they were very, very generous with the artifacts and things that they would bring in to tell about their country. That hat came from a young lady. Her name was Maria, to be exact. You'll probably notice that many Africans have Christian first names and then the African last name. Her name was Maria, and when she got all done, she wrapped up all her stuff, and she handed me that hat. And I said, oh, I don't want to take that. She said, no, in this way you'll always have something from my people, from my country, Zimbabwe, from the Ndebele people. And so she gave me that. This dashiki also was given to me by a young man from Zambia who was studying in the United States, studying business at the State University. So I wanted to show you these things tonight as we go along. You got your handouts tonight. The first one, of course, is the map. All the way through the series that I've done, I did a series here with you on the Middle East. I did a series on the Far East, one on Russia, for example. We did an ISIS lecture, if you remember, about a year ago, last January, and now this Africa one. My point is that geography has a lot to do with how historical things will evolve. As you come in, please do sign in and take your materials there. And the map will give you a pretty good idea of the layout of the countries. This is not very detailed, but it shows you some of the major cities and where the countries are, and they're done in different colors. We already touched on Tanzania last time we did East Africa. But it gives you an idea of the locations of things in this part of the world. You may notice that within South Africa, there are actually two countries inside of South Africa. My students would say, how can you have a country inside of another country? Well, both Swaziland and Lesotho were essentially British protectorates. And the British had promised to turn those areas over to South Africa after South Africa got its nominal independence in 1910. Well, they never got around to it. And by the time 1948 came along and apartheid was established, the British said, we're not going to turn these countries, these places inhabited by the Swazi people and the Soto people over to South Africa to be under apartheid. So they left them as is. They are actually sovereign countries. They have a seat in the UN. They have their own currency. They're essentially separate countries, and of course they are devoted to the particular ethnic group that's there. The other listing that you got here is the key terms. I put them up on the blackboard for you here, and here's a listing. These are the people and places and things you're going to hear about in the next 2 hours or so. Some of the names, like Nelson Mandela, for example, and David Livingston, for example, and Cecil Rhodes, are historical figures that you probably have heard about somewhere along the line in your travels and studies. Others might be new names to you, like Kenneth Kaunda, for example, and let's see here, F.W. de Klerk, Shaka Zulu, I'll tell you about him. This gives you an idea of the terminology. As I've done in all of my classes, I like to give you an idea of the words, of the names, of the places, and the things, so that in case you want to go and Google something and learn more about a particular person, you can do that. Speaking about learning more, here is the suggested readings. Again, every one of the lecture series that I've done, I've given you a reading list if you want. When I was a high school teacher, it was very tough to get my high school kids to read. They just did not want to read very much at all, unless they had to. But I know that seniors, people like us, are used to reading. In fact, we love reading. And many of us are retired by now. You have time, finally, in your life to pick up a book and read what you want to read. Well, here are some books that I've chosen for you. There are lots and lots and lots of books out there, and some of them really do have an axe to grind, a perspective, a point of view. I tried to find books that were balanced in their coverage of things. For example, the first one there is Magomero, Malawi Village, 1859 to 1989. Most of Africa life is in the villages. Okay, sure, they have the big cities, Johannesburg and Pretoria and so forth. Yes, but the African people, most of them live in the little towns and villages. Look at America here. Look at your Bedford, right? Your life essentially pretty well is centered in this particular community, and you have a marvelous community here. Well, this talks about a particular village in Malawi, again, one of the countries in southern Africa, and it traces it through many years and shows how these people had to adapt and change and modify their way of life as history went on. The Making of Contemporary Africa, Development of American Society, number 2 since 1800. Fern's book is a very, very good one, which essentially traces African society. And again, the development, what happens, of course, when the Europeans come in, that changes a great deal in the way that African society is going to have, is going to unfold. Long Walk to Freedom, Autobiography of Nelson Mandela. If there's one person you read about in southern Africa, read about Nelson Mandela, because he was one of the people who was involved in trying to overthrow the apartheid system. He was finally let out of jail, I think it was 1993, after 27 years in prison. When I visited South Africa, I saw on Robben's Island, they had a special island where they kept their most dangerous prisoners, I saw the cell. The cell that Nelson Mandela lived in was about 6 by 6. Imagine, 6 feet by 6 feet. That was it. Can you imagine living for 27 years in that kind of confined environment and not going completely mad? Well, when he did come out, he was still quite in command of his faculties. He, as you know, he led the African National Congress, and he became their first president after apartheid folded. So that story, of course, in the Nelson Mandela story, this is an autobiography too. A History of South Africa, that's about the general country of South Africa. It's a fourth edition. Whenever you see something that's a third or fourth or fifth edition, it means that there's been two or three or four predecessors to that, and they have revised it, and it's been so popular and so well written that they've put out another edition. So I think that's a good thing. I went to Princeton. This comes from the Yale University Press, but I have to admit, once in a while, something good comes out of Yale. Okay, I can tell you Yale-y jokes, but that's another story. Cry the Beloved Country, number 5, is a novel. Did anybody ever read Cry the Beloved Country? Right? Okay, it's a novel. I had to read that when I was in high school. And it's by Alan Paton, and it talks about the apartheid system. Yes, it's a story, but it's very, very accurate in terms of what was going on under the apartheid system. And it's a very, very easily read book as well. I write what I like, selected writings by Stephen Biko. Stephen Biko was one of the other leaders and voices of the black community against apartheid. He was not as popular or as famous as someone like Bishop Desmond Tutu, who of course, as you know, is an Anglican bishop who fought against apartheid as well. But he was extremely articulate, especially an excellent writer. And this talks about the writings that he put it out. It's a collection of his writings, edited, as you can see, by the University of Chicago Press. The struggle continues 50 years of tyranny in Zimbabwe. Some of the stories I'll tell you tonight are very good. Botswana, for example, is doing extremely well, has had 11 consecutive free and honest elections. That is a record for an African country. But Zimbabwe has been under a dictator, Robert Mugabe, since 1987. And I'll tell you how that came to be. Zambia, the first 50 years, again, the story of Zambia. Botswana and its national heritage, very, very good book about Botswana. If you want to read a story of an African country that made it after independence, there's a good example. And Namibia also, which is on the western coast, what used to be called Southwest Africa. So those are things that, if you care to, it has the ISBN number on that. I did that purposely so that you can find a particular book. Sometimes if you misspell a person's name or you don't have the title exactly right, you can't find it. But the ISBN number is unique to each individual book. So if you want to find a particular book, that ISBN number, if you go to Barnes & Noble's or a library or whatever, they can find it exactly. And that I wanted you to have. Also, I've got some pictures. I know that sometimes when you go to lectures, they have these PowerPoint presentations. Click, 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 click. And after the first 50 or 60 pictures, you've gone to sleep, right? So what I do is I put these on pieces of paper and pass them around so you can get a good look at them. And they do illustrate some of the things I'll be talking about. Here's some pictures of the Voortrekkers. Notice the covered wagon? When you see a covered wagon, you usually think of pioneers going out west, you know, out to beyond Missouri, out to Colorado and California and so forth. Well, the Voortrekkers, which were the Dutch settlers, what were called Boers, B-O-E-R, as opposed to B-O-R-E, which my students sometimes called me. In this case here, Voortrekkers actually decided to get away from the British. When the British began to push in from the coast, the Voortrekkers said, we're not going to live under British authority. We're going to move inland and resettle inland, starting such provinces as the Orange Free State, Transvaal, and other places. But that's a picture of them. This is a picture of modern Cape Town, which has a big sports center in it. And you notice in the back there's a big mountain. It's called Table Mountain because it actually looks like it's a table. It's flat on the top of it. And you can see it from the picture there. Here's Shaka Zulu. In the 1830s, a leader arose among the Zulu people, and he actually created an army, had fought both the Dutch and the British successfully, defeating them, considering these guys were working with shields and spears and bows and arrows against Gatling guns. It's extraordinary. He's known as the Black Napoleon because his tactics were so excellent that he was able to defeat these heavily armed Europeans several times. Eventually the Zulus were conquered, it's true. But I wanted you to see a picture of Shaka Zulu. Very good story there too. Here is an example of an apartheid sign. One of the signs you would have seen if you visited South Africa during the time of apartheid. It says, danger, natives, Indians, and coloreds. If you enter these premises at night, you will be listed as missing. Armed guards shoot on sight. Savage dogs devour the corpse. You have been warned. You imagine that? That's an actual sign that was used at that time. I remember myself when I went to South Africa, I did it in the 70s, they had signs along the beach, okay? This beach for whites, this beach for coloreds, this beach for black, this beach for Asians. Same ocean. What the heck's the difference? But is there? Everything had to be separated as such. Everyone got a pass, what we call the passbook. The passbook identified you and identified not only just your name and address and where you lived, your occupation, but also your race. And if you were found outside of the area that your race was assigned to, you could be arrested. Even if you were white, Didn't matter. You were out of your area, and you could be actually arrested. I remember going with some friends of mine. We went for the hotel, and we were walking to a restaurant that we heard was very, very good. The South African police showed up and said, you know, you really shouldn't be walking around like this at night through this area. We will give you an escort to the restaurant. Because, you know, we didn't know, but there were certain routes that white people just did not take at that time. So I wanted you to see what that sort of thing looked like. Here's Jacob Zuma, who's the South African president now. Here's F.W. de Klerk, who is the last apartheid president, the last president under apartheid, and he's the one that essentially made the agreements with Nelson Mandela to set up a structure by which they could transfer power from the majority white to an actual open election. Obviously, a majority of people were black, and therefore, when they had elections, real elections that counted the majority of people, then Nelson Mandela was elected. But de Klerk was the guy who had the courage to actually make those changes and negotiate the things that were necessary to do. Cecil Rhodes, that's where Rhodesia comes from. If you look at a modern map, there is no Rhodesia on the map now. It's now called Zimbabwe, and I'll tell you why they changed the name and where Zimbabwe comes from. Here is Robert Mugabe, unfortunately the dictator of Zimbabwe since 1987. Ironically, he's speaking at the United Nations. That's a funny thing. Here's Ian Khama, president of Botswana, elected in 2008, re-elected in 2014. Kenneth Kaunda, who was the first president of Zambia, very, very great leader. Kaunda is something like the Kenyatta. Remember Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya? You know, the great father of the country sort of thing. He would be the father figure for the Zambians, kind of like a Southern African Kenyatta. Edgar Lungu is the president of Zambia now. Dr. Livingstone, I presume, right? Livingstone not only just worked in East Africa, what was then called Tanganyika, but he also traveled southward. He's the first European to see Victoria Falls, which is along the Zambezi River in South Africa. I want you to see a picture of him. And I'll pass these out. I'll start them right here. Just pass them around. There's no hurry, but I wanted you to have a chance to take a look at those items as such. You all, I guess, know who I am. I want to say thank you to Wendy Aronson and Alison Chervensky, who is the director here, who have invited me. If you like what you hear and you like what you see, please tell them, because that way I'll be sure to be invited back. If I go down and say, wow, I was terrific, that doesn't necessarily convince them. It's much better if they hear from the audience that things went well. Can everybody hear me okay? I'm used to shouting, okay? My students would pretend they were deaf most of the time. The restrooms are around the corner directly behind me, behind this wall. So if you need to go, you go ahead. I'm used to writing toilet passes, but I don't do that anymore for you guys. Questions anytime. If you got something you want to ask, by all means, raise your hand, or if you want to contribute something. Has anybody here ever been to Southern Africa? The South Africa, where to?
Over Cape Town.
Cape Town?
Yeah, and just around.
When? This past October.
Well, my daughter lives there.
Oh, that's wonderful. Incredible.
Back in February.
Do you like it?
Yeah.
South Africa nice?
Yeah, it's just too far away.
That's too far away. Yeah, it's across the Atlantic, I understand. But I'm glad that you're here. If you want to contribute something, though, and comment on something, by all means.
I mean, I thought Zuma is being, they're trying to impeach him now.
I'm sorry? Yeah, there are some complaints against him now, and there's a movement in the South African Congress to impeach Zuma. That's going to have to wait and see how that works out. It's a political thing, and there isn't a whole lot of evidence, you know what I mean, on which to bring him up. But they're probably going to do something about him. I don't know what exactly, but I'll be getting to that as well. Let's see here. We'll take a break around 7:30 or so, as we usually do, and we'll certainly be glad to answer any other questions that you might have at that time and afterward. Some of you have come up and taken a look at the maps that I've put up here. This is a historical map. This is 1962, and it has names like Bechuana Land and the Federation of Nyasa and of Rhodesia and Nyasa Land on it. And you know, some of the names that were so in the 60s before these countries got their independence. This map, of course, shows the current situation. I put that one up because it shows the different peoples. Okay, and just as you saw in East Africa with the Kikuyu and the Maasai and the other tribal groups, there are very, very strong tribal identities down in this area. The Hosa, for example, the Swanas, for example, the Zulu, for example, are holding on to their identities, if you will, their social identities, their family identities with both hands. But I wanted you to have a chance to see those, and if you'd like to come up and look at them, you certainly can. Let's get started. Republic of South Africa. This is the flag of South Africa, this one here on this side. Notice all the different colors. It's now called the Rainbow Nation because obviously they have quite a few different kinds of people in the country. Jacob Zuma, that you mentioned, is under indictment now as the current president. We'll see how that works out. It's a big country, 25th largest country in the world, 471,000 miles, square miles in size. That's about 40 times the size of the state of Massachusetts. In terms of population, we're talking 55 million people. Massachusetts has about 7 million, so it's about 8 times the population here. Most of those people, of course, are of sub-Saharan African ancestry. It's a multi-ethnic society now. Variety of cultures. There are 11 different languages that are used in South Africa. Official languages. Afrikaans, which is actually derived from Dutch. English, North Soto, Ndebele, Soto, Swazi, Tswana, Tsonga, Venda, and Hosa, and Zulu all together. The top three of those would be Zulu and Hosa and Afrikaans, and English would be fourth. Even though it's fourth in terms of numbers of people who use that language every day, it's still used as a kind of a de facto, how should I say, common denominator language, as you've seen in some other countries in Africa. Ethnic groups. About 80% of the people of South Africa are, of course, of black ancestry. 9% colored. Colored is a mixture of black and white. Now consider that under apartheid, it was illegal for black and white people to socialize and certainly to marry and certainly to have children. And now it's not, but there still is a population group of about 9% of the population that would fall in that category. About 9% are white. And about 2% are Asian. Just as you saw in East Africa, the British brought in people from India and Pakistan, Malaysia, other colonies that they had in the world when they were first starting out to run the railroads and the mines and the businesses and so forth. And that population of Asian people is still there. And that's reflected, of course, in the religions. There are Hindu people in South Africa, Muslim people. Jewish population is there. About 80% of the people, of course, are Christian because of the work of the missionaries. I just did this lecture over at Carlton Willard over in Bedford, as you may know, which is a residence home. And one of the people in my audience was an Anglican, retired Anglican priest who had essentially lived in South Africa and worked in the missions and stuff there. And, of course, there's a high percentage of Christian people in South Africa. South Africa never has had a coup d'etat. Now, I know when you study about Africa, almost always you run across some dictator or some general or some colonel who takes over the country by force. It's never happened in South Africa. They have had elections all the way along for a good 100 years. But remember, the blacks did not have a vote until 1994. It was only white people who could actually vote in the elections. But they never had a coup d'etat. It's a mixed economy. Unlike some countries in Africa and in other parts of the world that depend upon a particular single resource, for example, Zambian copper, okay? The fact is South Africa does have a mixed economy, agriculture, industry, mining, and so forth. The seventh highest per capita income in the entire continent. But there, of course, are pockets of poverty and there are pockets of inequality of income distribution. Religions, as I mentioned, 80% Christian, Protestant and Catholic churches are there. I used to have fun with my students. I say, tell me the capital of South Africa. And one kid would say, Pretoria. And I'd say, right. Another kid would come up and say, Bloemfontein. And I'd say, right. Another one say Cape Town. I'd say, right. Well, the fact is they have three capitals. Pretoria is the executive capital, where the president and the executive branch sits. Cape Town is where the legislature actually sits, and Bloemfontein is the judicial capital, where the major courts are, like our Supreme Court. The biggest city, of course, is Johannesburg. Historically, remember the last time we got together, I handed out a map that showed some of the early archaeological digs that showed early hominids or all the early human-like creatures that had existed. Well, the Australopithecine Africanus have been found in South Africa, as they have in East Africa. That was in the Olduvai Gorge in Tanzania. I think you know about that. Well, they've also found remnants of these early creatures going back something like 3 million years. Bantu migrations about the 4th century in the Common Era, or 4th century AD, Bantu people began to travel south into southern Africa and crossing the Limpopo River. The Limpopo, by the way, borders between Botswana and Zimbabwe. The earliest people that we can identify are called the Hoshin people, or San. Some people call them the Bushmen. And they are still alive, they're still here, and they are hunter and gatherers, iron workers, basically, who live primarily in the desert of the Kalahari and the Namib Desert in the south. They're known as the Hoshin people. The two major large historic groups are the Hossa and the Zulu, and there is actually a KwaZulu province. KwaZulu is an actual province of South Africa. Natal and the East Cape provinces have the majority of these Hossa and Zulu. Hossa is spelled with an X, X-H-O-S-A, and of course Zulu. Now, what about the Europeans? We always talk about the British. The fact is, South Africa was first settled and explored by the Portuguese. You're probably, why would Portugal have an interest in South Africa? Take a look. At that time, we're talking now the latter part of the 1400s. You know about Columbus in 1492 and all that, okay? The fact is, though, in the latter part of the 1400s, Europeans began to desire to have control of and trade with the Far East. They wanted to get to the Spice Islands. They wanted to get to the exotic East. And the problem was that they were here, and that was there. Whoops. And all this was in the middle. What do you do? Well, there were some crazy people, an Italian, Columbus, right, who figured you could go east by sailing west. Now, remember, at that time, that was quite a crazy idea. Nobody knew what was out there beyond the Great Sea. Turns out, of course, he ran into the Americas. The Portuguese, however, were a lot more conservative. What they decided to do was to hopscotch down the continent. They knew that this existed, this huge plot of land, so they would hopscotch down the coast until they could find a way around it. That was the plan. And so in the latter part of the 1400s, in the 1480s and 1490s, the Portuguese sent out explorers that went down this way. That's why Angola, for example, was a Portuguese colony. Okay, and they finally got down to the south here. The first one to venture down that far, the year was 1485, was Diego Cao. But Bartolomeo Diaz, I like that name. Bartolomeo Diaz in 1487 followed Diego Cao, and by 1488 he cleared that cape. It was first called the Cape of Storms, by the way. Later on, King John II of Portugal changed the name to the Cape of Good Hope. As a result of that, the Portuguese were able to find their way around the African continent, around this tip, and to sail across the Indian Ocean to come to India and, of course, later on to Indonesia and other places. So the Portuguese were really the first to come into this area and to determine that they could get around that coast. Of course, they're followed almost immediately in the 1600s by the Dutch. And the Dutch set up a Dutch East India Company. You probably know the British East India Company was a Dutch East India Company, of course, in 1647. They decided that if they could put warehouses and gardens at the Cape of Good Hope, if you will, at the southern tip of Africa, they would establish a station there so that the Dutch ships that were going to the east and coming back from the east would have a place to reprovision and to pick up fresh vegetables and fruits and so forth so that the sailors could stay healthy. on the long trip across the Indian Ocean. They brought in slaves from Indonesia, from Madagascar, and India. And, of course, in the process of settling these way stations, if you will, these refueling stations, if you will, they clashed with the local Hossa people over the land rights that were there. Well, of course, the Dutch, you might remember, the Dutch got as far as Indonesia. This was the Dutch East Indies for many, many, many years. They didn't get their independence till 1949. Well, of course, wherever the Dutch went, who was right behind them? The British. Look at our history right here on the East Coast of the United States. I come from New York, okay? Albany was Fort Orange because the Dutch were the first to go up the river, Henry Hudson, right? The Dutch, Hudson was an Englishman in the employ of the Dutch. Later, when the British came in behind them, they changed the name to Albany. The Duke of Albany was a buddy of King George III at the time. So, effectively speaking, as soon as the Dutch began to be successful, the British followed right away. And again, in the 1700s, we're talking now around 1795, the British East India Company moved into the Cape, collided head-on with the Dutch, and established what they called the Cape Colony by 1806. In the 1820s, the British were fighting against the Hossas and the Dutch Boers, so those are the Dutch settlers, and the Zulus. And of course, I told you by 1838, they ran into Shaka Zulu. That slowed them down a while, but not forever. Many Dutch Boers decided that they would move away from the coast. That's the voortrekkers with the covered wagon that you saw. Moving into the northern areas of Natal, the Orange Free State, and the Transvaal. In 1867, diamonds were discovered. Ever heard of the Kimberley diamond mines? Okay. They're still internationally famous. And gold also. There was a gold rush in South Africa in 1884. And of course, the British pushed for control over the minerals. The British fought the indigenous peoples and the Boers. There was an Anglo-Zulu War in 1879. The Zulus at first won several of the battles, as I mentioned, but eventually were defeated by the British. This was followed in later on in 1881 and 1880 and 1881, and in 1899 and 1902, what's called the Boer Wars. You may have heard of the Boer Wars. This was the Boer Republics, the Dutch Republics, fighting against the British. And at first, again, they held off the British for quite a while, but eventually the British were successful. You might remember Winston Churchill, as a young man, actually fought in the Boer Wars. He was a British officer, so he had a taste of what war was about. Maybe his experiences helped him to make some good judgments later on when he became the leader of Great Britain in World War II. The modern history, well, the British Parliament gave nominal independence in 1910 and created what was called the Union of South Africa. I remember when I was a young man in school seeing a map and it said Union of South Africa on it. And that was the name that was given to them by the British in the early part of the 20th century. They got their full sovereignty from the United Kingdom in 1931. And in 1934, a united party, a political party with whites that were English and Dutch, got together and formed the core of this political party. In 1948, after the war, the National Party, they changed the name to National Party, was elected to power, and they established the formal segregation of the races. White and black and colored and Asian were separated. The word is called apartheid. Apartheid. Apartheid is on here someplace. I think I'll find it somewhere along the line. Bottom left, there it is, okay. It means separate, separation. I had a young lady come from South Africa. Very, very sharp young girl. She wore a beautiful green blazer and she had a springbok. You know, the animal looks like an antelope? Springbok on the pocket and everything. And I said, oh boy, this is gonna be great. This is probably the first absolute racist my kids are ever gonna meet. But she was very sweet about the whole thing. She explained it. She said, look, isn't it true that in nature, don't creatures of the same kind go together? You don't see crows and robins nesting together. People should be with their own kind. And what we've done is institutionalize that. Now, it sounds very reasonable, but to her, that was a normal sort of system. Remember, she was brought up under apartheid. And that's the way she saw the world, that there should be this separation. The black man sees his house in a circle, The huts are usually circular, and the white man sees his house in a square. What could be more fundamentally different? We're not the same. And look what happens when you try to be the same. And she would point out things out of the American newspapers of the race riots and the difficulties. We still have that when you have the mixture of black and white, and sometimes things go terribly wrong between them. So she tried to explain and justify how this system worked. And she felt that that was a reasonable system that kept everybody essentially happy. Everybody was with everybody of their own kind. And therefore, the country could proceed rationally. To her, it made a whole lot of sense. Now, we Americans, of course, disagree with that, generally speaking. We feel that people should be equal to each other and be joined together and be able to interact and so forth. But I think you'll agree that sometimes there are real problems between people who are of different backgrounds that way. But that's what apartheid was set up to do. It just institutionalized the separation of these different groups of people. Almost immediately, there was an African National Congress, a resistance movement that sprung up in the 1950s. You know that the international community condemned apartheid. There were sanctions, divestments of holdings and investments, boycotts, for example. The South Africans could not send athletes to the Olympics because they insisted on sending only white athletes. Now, what difference does it make what color a guy is if he can run and jump and swim and do these sports? You know? But to them, that was undoable. They could not possibly, well, as a result, they were actually boycotted out of the Olympics for quite a while. There was a constitution passed in 1983, Constitution Act, which eliminated the prime minister and established what's called a strong presidency, concentrating much more power in the presidency of that. South Africa left the Commonwealth of Nations. I have Commonwealth of Nations up there. That's a collection of countries that used to belong to the British Empire and that still cooperate with each other. For example, with visas, with travel back and forth, educational opportunities, that kind of thing. Well, they were they left the Commonwealth in 1961. They were readmitted back in 1994. So there was a terrific amount of upheaval as a result of this apartheid system. Now, how does it come apart? Well, by the 1970s, there were people on both sides of the coin who were working together to see if they could make a transition of power, a peaceful transition of power, rather than a revolution, a racial revolution. Transition of power by both the black and the white leaders. In 1974, there was a declaration of faith, that's what it was called, signed by Mangosuthu Buthelezi, who was one of the great Sotho leaders of the Sotho people, and Harry Swartz of the South African government, which began the process. In 1990, they lifted the ban on the African National Congress. The ANC had been an underground organization. They had been banned from all activity. And that's when Nelson Mandela was let out of prison in 1990, after 27 years. He had been sent to prison for sabotage. In 1993, F.W. de Klerk, you saw his picture, was the white president who opened up bilateral discussions with Nelson Mandela and began the process. They had their first actual national elections in 1994. The ANC, of course, won majority, and Nelson Mandela was the first black president of South Africa. They rejoined the Commonwealth. They joined, for example, a member of the Southern African Development Community, and they joined other organizations that would put them in league with other African countries around them. I must mention one other person who was instrumental in these things. His name was Desmond Tutu. He's still alive. He was the Archbishop of the Anglican Church of South Africa. And he fought, of course, against apartheid, HIV, AIDS, tuberculosis, racism, sexism, human rights violations, both within and outside of South Africa. He won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1984. And the Albert Schweitzer Humanitarian Prize in 1986, the Gandhi Peace Prize in 2007, the Presidential Medal of Freedom from our president in 2009. He wrote a book, I didn't put it on the list, I should have, called No Future Without Forgiveness. No Future Without Forgiveness. Well, you can imagine when this all turned over and the blacks got majority, there were an awful lot of people who wanted revenge. I mean, they'd been oppressed by the whites since 1948. If there's anybody who had a case to take out their vengeance. But Tutu was one of the black leaders who said, wait a minute, this will only tear the country further apart. No future without forgiveness. We have to forgive each other and move on. Now, that's a pretty tough pill to swallow after that kind of oppression for so long. But it's an excellent, excellent book. If you ever get a chance to see it, I'll read it. It's called No Future Without Forgiveness. Desmond Tutu. Desmond Tutu, who is one of the great leaders of South Africa. He's still alive. He's 85 or 86 years old by now. But he was really, really instrumental in trying to pull things together after. I think I've mentioned to you before, when you have a revolution and you throw out the old system or you throw out the old leader, does that necessarily mean everything's going to go okay? Look what happened in Libya when they got rid of Gaddafi. It's still a mess. Even Iraq got rid of Saddam Hussein, at all costs. Okay, what do you got? It doesn't necessarily mean that if you throw out the old system, whatever comes in after it is not necessarily guaranteed success and progress. So they have to work at this process of building South Africa using the resources intelligently. There still is some unemployment. The unemployment rate of the black people is still relatively high. They have to redo their monetary and fiscal disciplines, especially the redistribution of wealth. They still have the HIV and AIDS pandemic. There's a lot of resistance to immigration. The fact is they're taking in to South Africa now 250,000 refugees every year. Now, where are these people coming from? Well, they're coming from Zimbabwe, where conditions are terrible. They're coming from Burundi and the Congo, from Rwanda and Eritrea, from Ethiopia and Somalia. There's something like 3 million people in the country who are illegal in South Africa. So although the apartheid system was very, very oppressive, it certainly kept track of people extremely well. With this kind of numbers of people coming in, especially illegals, it's very, very difficult to handle all that. The last election was held in May of 2014. The African National Congress polled something like 62% of the vote, but there is also a Democratic Alliance that polled something like 22%. So there is an opposition. One of the things you have to look for when a country goes to a multi-party system is there an effective opposition? Is there somebody else who's going to stand up and say, wait a minute, we have a little different point of view on that. How about this? So as to prevent one political party or even one person from steamrolling anything that they want to go through. Of course, they have extensive wildlife in South Africa, Kruger National Park, the cheetahs, the white rhino, the wildebeest, the impalas, the hyenas, the giraffe. There still are safaris if you go to South Africa. If you ever get a chance, you can actually go on safari, you know, take you out in one of those jeeps and you can see the animals. They do have, of course, people with rifles stationed to keep the poachers away because some people believe the horn of the rhino has all sorts of medicinal characteristics to it. It's supposed to be a very special medicine for various things. And they actually will shoot an entire animal just to get the horn. So they do have to protect that. In international affairs, South Africa was a founding member of the United Nations, a founding member of the Organization of African Unity, or what's now called AAU, the African Union. In fact, the Prime Minister, Jan Smuts, wrote the preamble to the UN Charter back in 1945. They have been a mediator in African conflicts over the last 10 years. Burundi, for example, Congo, Zimbabwe. They are a member of the World Trade Organization and the IMF. They do trade extensively with China and Brazil, Germany, the United States, United Kingdom, and Spain. In science and technology, I remember very emphatically that when I would show South Africa to my students, the materials that I got almost always emphasized their technological breakthroughs and their technological work. For example, they had nuclear weapons back in the 1980s, but they destroyed them in 1990. And that's been verified by the United Nations, by the atomic group that they have that verifies that. But they have taken an awful lot of that nuclear technology and plowed it into nuclear power plants. so that they don't have to burn fossil fuel, they don't have to burn oil, they don't have to burn coal in order to produce power, especially for the big cities like Pretoria and Johannesburg and so forth. You might remember back in December of 1967, does the name Dr. Christian Barnard ring any bells to you, right? He's the first guy to do an actual heart transplant. Can you imagine taking a human heart from one person and putting it into another person? Skillfully enough that that recipient will live. That happened in 1967. Max Thier developed a vaccine against yellow fever. Another South African, Aaron Kluge, did some really extraordinary things with crystallographic electron microscopes. Sidney Brenner in 2002 won a Nobel Prize for molecular biology. So they are certainly nowhere near the bottom of the list. In fact, they're up near the top of the list when it comes to different kinds of technology, whether it's medical or atomic or other kinds of things. There's South Africa. Zimbabwe. Here is the flag of Zimbabwe. Notice it has multicolors on it as well, because Zimbabwe was Rhodesia. Rhodesia did have apartheid. They had the same system. They copied it from the South Africans. But how about this little eagle? What's that all about? Well, of course, when Zimbabwe finally got its independence, which actually occurred around 1980 or so, they didn't want to use the name Rhodesia, because Rhodesia was Cecil Rhodes. That was colonialism. That was imperialism. They wanted to have a different name. In the southeastern corner of the country of Zimbabwe, there is a site, an archaeological site, known as Great Zimbabwe. This site is what we believe to have been a center, a religious center, and a trading center for the Shona people back in the 1400s. Okay, so it's about 600 years old. It's all built out of cut stone, no mortar. And the stones are fit together so carefully that you can't get a credit card between them. So these guys were not bad engineers. They were obviously pretty good at doing this. The walls are 10 feet thick. Now, why would you need a 10-foot thick wall to surround this? Remember, this is before cannons were brought into that part of the world. And there's also a gigantic 18-foot conical tower that sticks up over the whole thing. Even more interesting is along the outer wall, there are 9 stone eagles like that, 9 of them. They believe that those 9 represented perhaps the 9 provinces, or maybe the 9 different groups that had contributed to this great Zimbabwe center. In the ruins of Zimbabwe, they have found Chinese Ming pottery. You know the blue and white Ming stuff? Okay. Persian glass beads. And items that clearly came, for example, from India. So it's obvious that there was some trade. If you look, Zimbabwe, however, is 200 miles inland. So it's very possible that there must have been some trade down that east coast. Remember I told you about Zheng He, the Chinese navigator who came in the 1440s to Kenya and what is now Tanzania? Right? Well, perhaps he sailed further down. How else would Ming pottery be found in the ruins of Zimbabwe 200 miles inland? It brings up some really interesting stories. And of course, they're continuing to do extensive archaeology at the site. But I wanted you to see why that has that particular kind of a stone eagle on the top, because it's found at that site along the outer perimeter, 9 of them, perhaps representing the 9 provinces that made up this empire. Well, the president of Zimbabwe now is Robert Mugabe. He's not under indictment. He's been in power since 1987. Basically, Zimbabwe is a landlocked country between the Limpopo and Zambezi rivers, area about 150,000 square miles, and that's about 15 times the size of Massachusetts. Population about 13 million. That's about twice our population here in Massachusetts. Capital is at Harare. 99.7% of the people are black. The Shona and Ndebele. Shona and Ndebele. That's N-D-E-B-E-L-E. Shona and Ndebele people are the majority. There are some white, some colored, some Indian people. 16 different languages are officially recognized, although English and Shona and Ndebele are the ones that are mainly used in the country. Religion 85% Christian, mixed with traditional beliefs, about 1% Muslim present there. The name, of course, comes from the archaeological site. Rather than using the name of Cecil Rhodes, who they saw as an imperialist, colonialist person, they wanted to name it against by something that came from their country, from their people, and so they chose the name Zimbabwe to name the country, okay, as opposed to just that one particular site. Zimbabwe was first used, the name was first used in 1960 by Michael Murama of the Nationalist Party. Later, it was used by other African Zimbabwe African Nationalist Union people in 1975. Robert Mugabe was involved with that as far back as 1975. And there was also an African Zimbabwe African People's Union, or ZAPU. That's what we got, ZANU and ZAPU up here. These were both Zimbabwe groups that were agitating for independence at that time, back in the 1970s. Now, basically speaking, as I mentioned, that great Zimbabwe was built probably back in the middle of the 15th century. There was extensive trade, as you can tell by looking at the ruins of these the city that they found, finding the gold and ivory. There's copper crosses also that have been found in that area, too. The British showed up under Cecil Rhodes in the 1890s. They expelled the Portuguese. The Portuguese had come in from the east, from what is now Mozambique. Remember, Mozambique and Angola, both of those were Portuguese colonies. So they had come in. The Portuguese had been there for a while. In fact, when the first Portuguese ran across Zimbabwe, I read the diary of one of their explorers, and they could not believe that black African people could build something like this. So they concluded it must have been the Egyptians. They must have come south from Egypt and built, well, anyway, they were there for a while. In 1890s, this became a self-governing colony, which came to be known as Southern Rhodesia in 1923. In 1965, they had, of course, absorbed in the 1950s apartheid. In 1965, the white majority government declared UDI. UDI. I think I put it on here. Unilateral Declaration of Independence. They just plain declared independence from Great Britain. We're out of here. That's it. We're not going to belong to you anymore. Well, you can imagine, in 1965, that was a rather unusual thing. It was very difficult for a country to actually get out from underneath their colonial power, but that's exactly what they did. There was a civil war from 1965 to 1980. And of course, just as South Africa had been isolated internationally, so was Rhodesia at that time. Robert Mugabe became the Prime Minister of Zimbabwe in 1980. He's part of the ZANU, the Zimbabwe African Nationalist Union, and 1980 apartheid in South Africa, in Zimbabwe, was outlawed. By 1987, though, Mugabe established an authoritarian regime. A security apparatus, of course, became dominant, widespread human rights violations, and he claimed that there were conspiring Western capitalist countries, sounds very much like the Russian rhetoric there, that had accounted for the economic woes of Zimbabwe. Even the two factions, ZANU and ZAPU, fought against each other for quite a long time. One of the things that they did, and this is one of the things that got them into a lot of trouble, was a land redistribution. Unlike in South Africa, where if you were a white farmer, or you were a white cattle rancher, or you were a white mine owner, you could keep your property and, you know, proceed on. In Zimbabwe, what they did was they threw the white settlers and the white farmers right off the land in 1996 and turned the land over to black farmers. And many of these black farmers, although they were perhaps of the right racial group, were not very good running large farms, plantations, if you will. They led to a serious drop in agricultural exports and some real limited success in terms of their economic abilities. Now, some other things about Zimbabwe I have to tell you. Victoria Falls is right along the border between Zambia and the Zambezi River. Tourism declined greatly when Zimbabwe turned to these policies. And in fact, what happened is the tourists stopped coming to Zimbabwe. They started going to the Zambian side of the falls. The airlines pulled out, for example, and 60% of the wildlife died off as a result because they were not managing that aspect very well. There's been some economic growth, but very, very high inflation. Just recently, the Zimbabwe government has issued a $100 billion note in their currency, $100 billion. It reminds me of those stories about, Germany in the 30s, where you needed a wheelbarrow full of marks to buy a loaf of bread, that kind of inflation. Well, that's essentially what's going on. But they've got resources, gold, large platinum deposits. They have diamond mines as well. And of course, the problem, of course, is to make sure that those resources are properly exploited. The trouble is that the money that comes in from the platinum and the gold and the diamonds usually goes in the pockets of the military officers who are, of course, supporting Mugabe. So they don't want the system to change. They're making money unbelievably, and so is Mugabe. The biggest issue, of course, is human rights. According to Amnesty International and human rights watch groups, Zimbabwe violates the rights, basic human rights to shelter, food, freedom of movement, residence, assembly, protection of the law. There have been assaults on the media, political opposition, human rights activists. Freedom of the press and speech, of course, have been suppressed. The BBC, which is a worldwide British broadcasting corporation, you know the BBC, operates all over the world. They've been thrown out. So has CNN. Just thrown out of the country, not allowed to report or be present in the country at all. And some of the newspaper offices that were in opposition to Mugabe have been closed, some of them bombed and taken right out of operation. Not a very bright outlook, and as I mentioned, there's been a lot of refugees that have left Zimbabwe and now poured into South Africa. And that creates a real problem for South Africa. On that negative note, I have to tell you that the next country we're going to, which is Botswana, formerly called Bechuanaland, is an African success story. And after our break, we will pick up with Botswana, and I'll be able to cheer you up with some of the good news that's coming out of Botswana. We'll have a little break. As bad a case as Zimbabwe is, Botswana is a good case. It's an African success story. The capital is at Gaborone, as I said. Strong tradition of stable representative democracy, uninterrupted, democratically honest elections. I think they've had 11 elections in a row since they got their independence in 1966. Which is somewhat of a miracle. The fellow who is the president now is Ian Khama. I think you saw him in the pictures that were passed around before. Basically, however, you know, you think when you really read the statistics, you say, my gosh, they've got all this stuff stacked against them. 70% of the country is in what's known as the Kalahari Desert, which is a very, very dry, desolate sort of place. The area is about 225,000 square miles. That's about the size of France, for example, or about 22 times the size of Massachusetts. Most of it is flat. They do have the Limpopo River basin to the north of them, but it is a very, very difficult environment that they have to work in. Only about 2 million people. The last couple of countries we visited had 55 million, 27 million, you know, unbelievable. In this case, we got 2 million people. It's probably one of the most sparsely populated countries in the entire world. Ethnic groups. The ethnic group is known as Tswana, T-S-W-A-N-A. T-S-W-A-N-A. You put a B-O in front of that and you got the country Botswana. Okay? The Tswana people, Kalanga, Basara, there's a population of about 3% white, but most of them are 79% Tswana, 11% Kalanga, 3% Baswara, and the San, or the Bushmen of the Kalahari, are the Hoshin people who live in Botswana. I remember showing a movie to my kids, and the kids were always fascinated with this, that in the desert, Kalahari, the Hoshin people, the San, the Bushmen, take an ostrich egg, drill a hole in the top, dump out the contents. Imagine the egg you'd have out of that. Okay, that's quite a amount. And they use the shell as a canteen. Because nature has insulated the shell so carefully, so well, that even in the hot, dry conditions, water stays without evaporating inside the canteen. Because the egg omelet you get would be this size. But anyway, they use the ostrich eggs for canteens and other things, of course, as well. They are hunters and gatherers, so they're familiar with the particular kinds of roots and plants and so forth, what little things that are there. Probably one of the most best adapted people to their environment in the world. Religion, about 70% Christian. However, there are Mormons, Dutch Reformed, Roman Catholic, some Muslims, some Hindus, and Baha'i. I don't know if you're familiar with the Baha'i faith. There are Baha'is present in Botswana. Languages, the official language, of course, is English. The reason is it is a common denominated language that everyone can agree upon. Setswana is the language of the Swana people, so they use that as well. And of course, Kalanga and Ndebele people have their own languages as well. But by and large, English is used as a kind of common denominator. I just heard from a friend of mine here that there is a movie called The Gods Must Be Crazy from 1991. Do you remember that?
No.
Okay. Which is a delightful movie. I remember seeing it myself. It was in the motion picture stations. And it's also available on DVD. So that was shot in Botswana. And it does show the interplay of people and the equality among the people, which is very, very good. The diverse habitats, as I mentioned here, there's a Chobe National Park. They have the largest elephant population in Africa. The Kalahari has a game reserve and also a sanctuary for a rhino in Botswana. Originally, the people who were the original inhabitants, as near as we could tell, are the San or the Bushmen people. Gradually, around the year 1300 in the Common Era, large chieftains moved in from the north, and later, of course, later on from the south, Shaka Zulu from the Zulu nation actually pushed up into what is now Botswana for a while. The colonial, the contacts with the Europeans, largely they're looking for ivory from the elephants, animal skins, that kind of thing. Some trading. Missionaries were there by 1880. The Christianization completed with the baptism of King Kama III, who reigned from 1875 to 1923. There were wars between the Tswana and the Ndebele people. Those two tribes did war with each other over land, that kind of thing. But those settled down by the 1880s. 1885, the British put Bechuanaland, they called it Bechuanaland, as a protectorate. And the southern areas of what was Bechuanaland was ceded to the Cape Colony. 1910, as I mentioned, there was a Union of South Africa created, but Bechuanaland, Basutoland, which is now called Lesotho, and Swaziland, those three areas, were not included. They were supposed to be incorporated into South Africa later on, but the United Kingdom delayed. By 1948, when apartheid got started, the United Kingdom decided that they would not incorporate them into South Africa. So essentially, Bechuanaland, or what we now call Botswana, and Lesotho and Swaziland were not included and actually stayed as sovereign countries. 1964 to 66, the United Kingdom worked with Botswana to establish democratic self-government. They built the capital at Gaborone. They got their independence the 30th of September, 1966. Seretse Khama was their first president. He was reelected twice. Then Ket Masire was elected in 1984, 1989, 1994. Festus Mugabe in 1999, 2004, and the present president, Ian Khama, was elected in 2008 and re-elected in 2014. So there's been a succession of actual real elections, again supervised by the United Nations to make sure that they were fair and equitable and so forth, 11 of them in a row, and that has kept the country peaceful transition of power from one group to another. They have had a border dispute with Namibia. But instead of going to war with their neighbor, they brought it before the International Court of Justice, which is in The Hague in the Netherlands. That's part of the United Nations. I don't know if you know about that. But the International Court hears cases from all over the world, sometimes border disputes, fishing rights, all kinds of things. And in this case, Namibia and Botswana brought the case to the International Court of Justice, and they ruled in Botswana's favor in 1999. Now, Once, Botswana was one of the world's poorest countries, but it was transformed into a middle-income country comparable to Mexico. It has the fourth highest gross national product in Africa. Now, if you think about that, for a country that's 70% desert, I mean, you know, lack of resources, that's doing pretty good. High level of economic freedom compared to other African nations. Highest sovereign credit rating in Africa, very solid banking system. They're a member of the African Union, the South African Development Community, the Commonwealth of Nations, the United Nations. The UN has helped them a great deal in what's called the UNDP. Have you ever heard of that? The United Nations Developmental Program, which goes into countries in the world and helps them to develop their resources in a good way. For example, working with water resources, with farmers, mineral resources, that kind of thing. They do have diamonds and golds and uranium and copper. Those resources, 40% of the government revenues comes from that. But unlike some other places where the money goes into some general's pocket or some president's pocket, the money is plowed back into the infrastructure of the country to build up the roads, the clinics, the schools, the hospitals, and so forth, so that they're getting something out of that. Anybody knows that if you take something out of the earth, there's a limit to how much is going to be there. You're going to run out of oil eventually. You're going to run out of copper eventually. You're going to run out of resources like diamonds. So the question is, what is the greatest benefit, long-lasting benefit, you can get out of those resources? And in this case, they've been intelligent about using the resources from that. They do have livestock and cattle in some rural areas, but they have to be very careful on managing their water resources because they don't have a whole lot. They do have problems. HIV and AIDS is still high in that part of the world. And what's happened with the Sana, the Bushmen, since 1995, they've been moved out of their traditional areas and put onto reservations. Does that sound familiar? Right? Look what we did with the Native Americans here. We wanted their land, so we said, oh, why don't you move to Ohio or Oklahoma, you know, the Cherokees. You probably know the stories about those things. Well, that's essentially what's happened here. These people are hunter-gatherers, but they've been evicted from their region where they're used to adapting, where they know how to live. And this has made some real problems for the country. However, the government is working to harmonize the needs of the San, of the Bushmen, with the environmental and economic needs that go along with the national plans. So they are dealing with that, and that's something that they do have to do something about. Finally, I thought I'd talk a little bit about Zambia. Remember that Rhodesia, there was a northern Rhodesia and a southern Rhodesia. Southern Rhodesia became Zimbabwe. Northern Rhodesia, okay, got its independence in 1964, and the name Zambia comes from the Zambezi River, that river that has opened that area. The capital is at Lusaka. The president is Edgar Lungu. Area 290,000 square miles. Now, I know when you read numbers off like that, you say, well, how big is that? Well, that's about 29 times the size of Massachusetts. It's an area of high plateaus, some hills, and, of course, they have the advantage of having the Zambezi River Basin right there. It's relatively moderate climate because of elevation. There is also a huge dam known as the Kariba Dam, which has been built on the Zambezi, which produces enormous amounts of hydroelectric power. And in today's world, a country that's struggling to move ahead, you've got to have power resources. And you don't want to start burning coal, and oil is very expensive if it's not in your country. And so hydroelectric power or atomic power are resources that can be used. In this case here, they're using the Zambezi River. Population about 16 million people. That's about twice, a little bit more than twice the population of Massachusetts. There are 73 different ethnic groups that are recognized. Small numbers of Asian and Europeans there too. Highly urbanized. You wouldn't think of Zambia as a country that has a lot of cities. This is the flag of Botswana. The blue and the white, the black stripe in the middle, and this is the flag of Zambia. It also has an eagle on it, but that has nothing to do with Zimbabwe. I wanted to show you what those look like. 44% of the people of Zambia live in cities. There are 9 major groups in the country: Nyanja, Tonga, Bemba, Lunda, and other groups. Again, they also have gotten refugees from Zimbabwe and from Angola and the Congo because of other refugee problems that have been going on internally in those other countries. Religiously, they are Christian. In fact, they put it in their constitution in 1996 to make it the official religion of the country. There's also a great deal of blending of traditional religions with Christianity. This Christianity that's there involves groups such as the Seventh-day Adventist, the Pentecostal Church, the Anglican Church. There are also small numbers of Muslims, Baha'is, and Ashkenazi Jewish that are present in Zambia. The language officially, English, because it's the one that everybody can agree upon. But Nyanja and Bemba and Tonga are the native groups, native languages that are used there too. The Zambian National Broadcasting System broadcasts in something like 16 different languages. I remember seeing from South Africa a sports program that was all done in Zulu. Can you imagine listening to a soccer game explained in Zulu? This is one of the ways that they try to use modern technology to facilitate the use of the languages of those countries. Historically, as I mentioned, the Hoshin or Shan or Bushman people were there. After the 12th century, Bantu expansion came in from the north, the Tonga people, and also the Soto people from the south, the Tonga from the north are coming in. Europeans. I think I mentioned to you before that Portugal was the one that hopscotched down the coast. Angola, they kept going, crossed around here, out the Indian Ocean, but they also kept going up to the coast. Mozambique, over here on this side, on the eastern side, and Angola were Portuguese colonies all the way up to 1978. Okay, what happened was that in 1795, the Portuguese actually sent explorers an expedition led by a Portuguese named Francisco de la Senta. I think his name is on the list there, Francisco de la Senta, who came west from Mozambique, traveling east. The idea is they wanted to travel right across the continent to connect the Portuguese holdings on the west side, on the east side, Mozambique, with Angola on the east side. Well, as they traveled across, they passed right through what is now Zambia, and of course claimed that for the Portuguese crown. In 1855, about half a century later, the Scottish explorer David Livingstone was the first European to see Victoria Falls. The local people call it Mosi Utonga, the thundering smoke. If you've ever been to Niagara Falls or any place with those huge falls, you get this whole lot of water vapor in the air, and it almost looks like smoke. Victoria Falls was essentially seen by Livingstone. Well, right behind him, of course, in 1888, comes along Cecil Rhodes. There is some conflict with the local people. In 1895, he sends his American scout. He had a scout named Frederick Russell Burnham, who went out and scouted areas for him. And he was the guy that found the copper deposits in Zambia. If you've ever heard, if you know something about copper, the copper mines of Zambia are legendary. Absolutely huge reserves of copper found in that part of the world. Well, of course, as long as those resources are there, the British are going to want to control those. By 1911, various provinces were put together to form the protectorate known as Northern Rhodesia. Southern Rhodesia became Zimbabwe, as I explained. Northern Rhodesia was put under the control of the British Colonial Office. Now, in 1953, what happened was that the British, not knowing exactly what to do with these places, created a federation. They put together Rhodesia, Northern Rhodesia, and Nyasaland. Now, Nyasaland is Malawi, the little country that's kind of draped across the edge of the lake. There's a Lake Malawi there. They federated those two together. And that federation lasted for quite a while, all the way from 53 to about 1961. But by this time, the Zambian people themselves wanted to get their own independence. And a leader arose among the Zambian people, Kenneth Kaunda, who I said is something like the Zambian version of Kenyatta, formed a united independent party. There were independent elections held in 1962, The Federation was dissolved in 63, and by 64, January of 1964, Kenneth Kaunda was elected as the Prime Minister. By October of that year, they developed an actually independent Republic of Zambia, and Kaunda was elected as their first president. Now, he was actually in power from 1964 to 91. When you see 64 to 91, you say, oh my God, that's almost 30 years. The guy must have been a terrible dictator. He wasn't. The fact is, he was universally loved, and he made some wonderful decisions, kept things moving along in a positive way, and people just kept reelecting him. Sometimes, when you have a multi-party system and you have elections and so forth, people are apt to vote for people that they have seen do good things in the past, that have a good track record, so to speak, and to keep them going as long as they can. Remember, our concept of term limitations and all that is not usually found in many parts of the world. In many parts of the world, they find somebody good, they hold on to them, and they don't care how many terms. In this case, he was president until 1991. After Kaunda, there was more multi-party demonstration and democratic movement going on. They had a president named Frederick Chiluba, 1991 to 2002. Levi Manasuasa in 2002. He died in office, 2008. Not a military coup or anything, just died naturally in office. Rupia Banda, 2008 to 2011, who was defeated by Michael Sata, who again died in office 2014. The last elections they had was January of 2015. So that was about 2 years ago. And Edward Lungu was elected the sixth president. So again, there's a collection of successive elections wherein you had free democratic elections, expressions, multi-party, opposition, the whole business there, what we would consider to be a decent election, all the way through, starting all the way back in 1966, where they started, 1964, where they started. Now, what about the economy? Well, I mentioned that Kariba Dam, that electric power, produces tremendous amount. That power can be sold, you know what I mean, to other countries, and some of the countries around Zambia buy that. There was a Tazara, T-A-Z-A-R-A, a Tanzania-Zambian railroad that was built between Zambia and Dar es Salaam, Tanzania, to get the copper out. It's nice to have lots of copper, but if you're a landlocked country and you've got no way of getting it out of your country, how are you going to sell it? So there was an actual railroad that was built back in the 1960s and 70s for the movement of copper products from Tanzania out to Dar es Salaam. There is a Tanzama oil pipeline. Likewise, there is some oil, not a lot, but there is an oil pipeline that's been built between Tanzania and Dar es Salaam. And there's a Tanzam highway, actual roadway for truck traffic that's been built between Tanzania and Zambia. So there's three major projects there that allow the Zambians, even though they're landlocked and they're inland, to get their products out through Tanzania. And that has helped them a terrific amount. Now, some of these projects, like the Tazara thing and the Tanzam highway, were financed by the Chinese. What the heck has China got to do with South Africa? Well, you have to understand that back in the 70s and 80s, the People's Republic of China, Communist China, was trying to find places in other parts of the world where they could insert themselves, where they could get themselves some influence, okay, and especially raw materials. You know now that China has a terrific industry going. Of course, they've also got pollution problems like you wouldn't believe, but they have come a long way industrially. Where are you going to get the raw materials? I know when you look at a map of China, you say, this is immense. They don't. There isn't that much coal. There isn't that much iron ore. There isn't that much copper. There isn't that much platinum in China itself. If you can get it from a third world country, a smaller country, and trade them not just in money, but in technology. For example, the building of a highway. Now, that's not really advanced technology. We're not talking about rocket science here, okay? Or even a railroad. That's fairly easy to do, technologically speaking. And if you can do that and win their confidence and get a percentage of the materials that are coming out, that to them was a worthwhile investment. Ideologically, communism has not worked very well in Africa at all. They tried it in Angola. completely bombed. The same thing with Tanzania and Zambia, other places where they've done these projects. They also tried to incorporate their ideology, you know, the Red Book and Chairman Mao and all that. Didn't go over at all. It's completely different, completely opposite, completely against, in many ways, their traditional ways of doing things. And it has not ideologically caught on. But in terms of financially, in terms of technology, and in terms of resources, the Chinese have done extremely well in this part of the world. And they still have a fairly good trade balance with them. Their exports are $7 to $8 billion a year. But there still is some unemployment and underemployment. The idea is to get people into the areas where they need them. What happens is that people have a tendency to stay in their own home areas because of the tribalism. They don't want to go 200 miles or 300 miles away for a better job. They want things in their own backyard, and sometimes that just doesn't work out too well. Most rural Zambians are subsistence farmers. Although there are opportunities, of course, in the minerals, in the, as I mentioned, the copper that's there and other minerals too. Now, that's another thing. If you depend so much on one resource like copper, what happened is in the 1970s, there was a drop in international copper prices. And the Zambians took a terrifically big hit as a result of that. The copper industry finally came back around 2002, and what happened is that they privatized a lot of it. It had been run by the government. What happens in Africa very often is that when a country gets started, most of the major industries are run by the government because they don't have the personnel, the people, the historic groups of people who are going to be able to take over these businesses and run them like we do here in America. In America, you've got lots of people who have got lots of ideas and can, you know, run businesses left and right. In many parts in Africa, they don't have that expertise. They don't have that background. So the governments start out and gradually, slowly, sometimes very quickly, sometimes very slowly, but usually fairly slowly, they privatize. In other words, they essentially sell off copper mines, or they sell off a railroad, or they sell off so that other people can be doing that. And as a result of that, when there's a profit motive, they're going to work twice as hard to get it going. Government enterprises, as by and large, do not work very well because there's no profit. There's no motive involved, and no profit motive. And they're not going to make anything out of it. So the copper production has rebounded. They also have tin and nickel and uranium. Since the year 2011, copper prices have gone up by 250%. So in the last 5 years or so, the price of copper has gone back up, and that has helped them a lot. Of course, Victoria Falls and the national parks are there for tourism. That's another source of income for them. So those are the four majors: Botswana, Zambia, Zimbabwe, and South Africa that I had prepared to speak with you tonight. Are there any questions or things you'd like further amplification about? Here I am.
So the British primarily set all the boundaries of these countries, more or less.
Right, right. Some of it was actually done, well, Cecil Rhodes. You know, technically speaking, he never held a government position. He was just an entrepreneur. But they drew the lines, essentially. Now, one of the things they did do, though, was to pay attention to the tribal groups. In East Africa, they didn't. But in South Africa, maybe by that time, they learned their lesson. And they tried to keep things, like the Swanas are mostly in Botswana. You know what I mean? The Zulus are mostly in Zululand. And, you know, the Sotos are in Lesotho. The Swazis are in Swaziland. They tried to keep things fairly close. Some of the borders were drawn by governments. Portugal, for example, drew the borders from Mozambique and Angola. Okay, Namibia was Southwest Africa. Southwest Africa was German Southwest Africa, and then the British took it over. So by and large, it was drawn by other people, but they were a lot more intelligent about drawing the borders to try and keep the ethnic people alive. I guess, you know, it's a funny thing, but the colonialism, the history of colonialism in Africa, they seem to have learned as they went along. You know what I mean? They were winging it in the beginning. you know, right? But they seem to have learned a little bit more about how to manage things to the best, not just for their own benefit, which of course they were there for, but also to make sure that the people would be able to work with them in a much more cohesive way. If you draw boundaries right through the middle of somebody's tribal land, well, look what's happened to those oil pipelines and so forth. You've seen that on television. You know, they're going right through the sacred grounds of the Sioux. Well, what do you expect them to do? Say, oh, yeah, sure. Now, of course they're going to protest, naturally, because to them, that ground is sacred. And most human beings feel it's necessary to have something that is sacred and not defiled, if you will, by having this machineries and all this other stuff go through. So in this case, they were a little bit more effective in drawing the boundaries right that way. The exception to that is Portugal, who drew the boundaries for Mozambique and Angola. Other questions? Other things you want to know about?
Madagascar. Sir? What's the situation with Madagascar?
What's the situation in Madagascar? Strange you should ask. I just happen to have a little bit on that. Yes. Madagascar, formerly known as the... let's see here. It was formerly known as Malagasy, the Malagasy Republic. I think I have some here. There it is. It's the fourth largest island in the world. A biodiversity hotspot. 90% of the wildlife found in Madagascar is found nowhere else on Earth. It's something like the Galapagos Islands, you know. The early people settled there probably somewhere around the year 2000 BC. There's a kingdom of Marina people in the early 19th century. The French came in from 1897 to 1960. They've had four constitutions since their independence. Their independence was granted by France in 1960. No war of independence necessary. The French just decided to let them go. The president of the country was forced out in 2009 because of, charges of corruption. The last elections, which were fair, were held in 2013. The French and Malagasy languages are spoken in the island. 24 million people, most of them, live on less than $2 a day, so there isn't a whole lot of economic development there on the island. Ecotourism and agriculture is the main backbone of the economy at that time. People and culture are a blend of East Asia and Bantu. They believe that settlers in outrigger canoes came from southern Borneo around the year 550 AD. Now take a look at this. Here is Madagascar, right here, off the coast, okay? The languages spoken there, Malagasy, for example, are more related to the languages of Indonesia than they are to any of the African Bantu languages. They believe that outrigger canoes, you know, the ones that the South Pacific natives used and all that stuff, actually crossed the Indian Ocean about 1,500 years ago and brought their civilization, their culture with them. So it is quite a different kind of place. The ecotourism, because of the wildlife, is found nowhere else in the world at that particular place. So it is a country that is still struggling along, but they're making progress, especially agriculturally. Tea, for example. Madagascar is pretty mountainous in the interior, okay? And because of the high altitude, they can grow tea. And tea, of course, is a commodity that you can sell anywhere in the world. It's believed, of course, that the tea was brought over from India, probably by the French. As you remember, the French were in India as well. There's a Battle of Plassey in 1857 between the British and the French, which determined who would control India. Did you know that? Yeah. The French were in India first. Before that, the Portuguese, then the French, then the British. Anyway, the tea probably came from India and was cultivated on the island itself. Other questions? Yes.
Mauritius. Does that belong to?
No, it's a separate country.
Okay.
It's a separate country.
Since
yeah.
Like
no, it's a little island country off the coast, yeah. Out this way. I don't think my map goes far enough. It's over there. You've got it on yours.
Yeah,
okay.
On, yeah.
Yeah. No, it doesn't belong to Madagascar. It's a separate country by itself. Other questions? Okay. Well, thank you. Yeah. I'm sorry. You had.
Do people go between these countries a lot?
Migration.
Migration?
Well, what it's been refugees. It's been people who've had to move. Remember, the African people have a terrific sense of place, and they don't want to leave their native place, especially where the native, where the ancestors are buried, if it's unless it's absolutely necessary. Yes, there are people who are engaged in trade all the time back and across the borders. It's not like there's big walls or barbed wires or guys with guns. The borders are pretty open in these areas. There's no real problem, one thing. But they have to be very careful because, you know, people tend to stay in their own areas unless they have to go. Right. You know, there are different money systems, too. You know, yeah.
I thought the people in South Africa were rejecting migration, the immigrants.
Yeah, they are, as much as they can. But, you know, people pour across the borders all the time. Mm-hmm. Donald Trump hasn't built a wall yet for that. But anyway, there is some resistance there. But some of the other countries, Zimbabwe, for example, people have left Zimbabwe because of the terrible political climate, going into Zambia, going into Botswana. But again, you know, these countries are relatively poor. How much can they absorb? You know what I mean? You're here in Massachusetts. Well, imagine if 250,000 people from New Hampshire crossed the border every year into Massachusetts. What would you do with all those people? Well, you know, how would you possibly provide for their needs and so forth, you know? Any other questions? Yes.
The ones that are going into Europe, how far down in Africa are those
people? Oh, the ones that are going to Europe, they're mostly the northern areas here. Okay. Some from Eritrea, Ethiopia, Sudan, but largely the northern areas. You don't get very many migrations from here, no. It's way too far away.
Sahara Desert and everything.
Yeah. You know, well, the Sahara Desert North, basically. Other questions? Yes, sir.
The Great Zimbabwe, the ruins found there.
Yes.
Were there other examples of heavy stone construction?
Oddly enough, they haven't found anything. Just that one site.
So was that developed spontaneously, locally?
Must have been. Unless you believe the Egyptians came down and built it for them. I mean, that was the theory, but it must have been developed over, you know, probably over 100 years or so as a trading place. They believe that large conical tower was probably a grain silo, a grain storage device, they think. That might have been the reason for it. Why were the walls 10 feet thick? Well, this is before the Europeans showed up with cannons. Why would they have to build something that thick? And what's the reason for the exact precision? You know what I mean?
And the skills to do it,
which obviously show that they had something going there for a while. And the Chinese porcelain, the Persian glass beads, the artifacts that are of Indian origin. It's a great mystery. Great mystery. Look it up. Read some more about it. Find out. Come back next time. Tell me the answer.
I miss what you're talking about.
He asked about Zimbabwe, Great Zimbabwe. And he asked basically if that was a unique thing, if there was any other sites that have been found of
what
that type.
What is the site called?
It's called Great Zimbabwe. Okay. Great Zimbabwe. That's in the southeastern corner of the country, now called Zimbabwe, formerly called Southern Rhodesia. Okay, Great Zimbabwe. You can Google it and take a look at it, and it's really fascinating stuff. Fascinating stuff. Yes, sir.
Curious why Zimbabwe elected to build a highway. Train to Zambia for their exportables. Why did they not go across Mozambique to the ocean?
They went from Zambia through Zimbabwe, this way. Zambia to Zimbabwe. Zambia to Tanzania. Zambia to Tanzania, to Dar es Salaam.
Not from Zimbabwe,
from Zambia. Zambia's got the copper. And you know the Chinese jumped on that. And, you know, there's been some American aid too. One other point I want to make before we split: African countries, even when they're desperately in need, are very leery of outside help. To them, that smacks of neocolonialism. Here we go again. The outsiders are going to come in and do us a favor, but they're going to want something in return. Here we are now being colonized economically. maybe they're not putting a flag in our soil anymore, but they're going to now, they're going to own us financially. So they're very, very careful about who, what countries come into their country, doing what kind of projects, and what's expected in return. Okay. So far, the thing with the Chinese and Zambia and Tanzania has worked out okay, because they didn't really pull a lot out of that. Even with the United States and France and England and other countries, Germany, for example, which is an economic superpower now, the Germans also have extensive activities in other countries of the world, building machinery places and, for example, putting in car assembly plants. You know, you can buy a Mercedes in Lusaka, Zambia, or a BMW, can you imagine? But they build a factory there and they hire local workers. So the government says, okay, we can live with that. It employs our people. It gives us a piece of technology we wouldn't ordinarily have. Apple, for example, IBM, a lot of the high-tech companies that put out cell phones and that kind of thing, they're going to different countries as well because everybody wants to have one of those. You know what I mean? And it's a product that, you know, people want to have, and therefore they can do. But they're very careful because they don't want to be owned. They don't want to be victims of colonialism in a different form because they already had that. They were already over underneath somebody else and controlled by them and told what to do, and you know what I mean. And they're very, very careful about it. Yeah.
I remember reading something about, you're talking about the Chinese in Africa.
Yes.
And that there's a problem because the Chinese build something, and then they bring their own Chinese people in to work the place.
Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't.
They don't get any of what you're talking about, the ability to do it themselves, because
right.
they're sort of just left out yep. of it.
On some of the projects, the Chinese did bring large numbers of workers or engineers or people in. Other projects, they didn't.
Oh, okay.
They just brought the engineers in that would direct. And that's why, and they did that because they were complaints.
Right.
Because those countries said, hey, what are you doing here? Mm-hmm. If you're doing this, we want our people to be in it. And it also gives them a sense of ownership, too.
Right.
We built this railroad, not somebody from the other side of the planet. Mm-hmm. We built it. They have some sense of ownership of it. They're going to maintain it. Mm-hmm. You know, you can give them 100 brand new tractors, but unless somebody can maintain those things, mm-hmm. they're going to be useless in a year, mm-hmm. right? So you have to give them some sense of ownership of that, train their mechanics to fix those things. I remember reading a story. In fact, I talked to one young man who's a farmer. His father was a farmer, and it's very, very expensive to have equipment, you know, like a tractor I don't know much about farm equipment, but there's different kinds of equipment that you need for plowing and for seeding and so forth and so on. And what happened was that no one of his friends, of his father's friends, could afford to buy a tractor. To them, it would be like $4 million, you know what I mean, in terms of relative value. So what they did was they set up tractor farms and tractor stations where there would be 6 or 7 tractors and a mechanic. And each farm would come borrow the tractor, okay, and use it and then give it back, okay? The fuel for the tractor, the farmer would pay for out of his grain or whatever he was growing. You know what I mean? Or he'd give a cow or something, whatever it was. But whatever, that's how he would do it. And that way, a lot of people could get benefit of this high-tech equipment. And it kept running because there was a mechanic there who was paid by the government to make sure those pieces of equipment were ready all the time. And every time a farmer came to pick up a tractor, there was one that was running in good shape, got the spare parts, etc. You know what I mean? My father used to tell me that no piece of equipment is worth anything unless you got the spare parts for it.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. You know what I mean? Because sooner or later, every kind of equipment that you can think of is going to have some sort of a breakdown, and you're going to lose it. You know. Now, I know here in America, we just throw it out and get another one. But most places in the world, you have to keep things going, and the tractor stations worked very well. Okay, that fellow told me. He was from Kenya, to be exact. Other questions? Comments?
What are you going to cover in the next session?
The next session is going to be West Africa. Okay, we're going to be going into Nigeria, Boko Haram. Remember that? Okay. We're going to take a look at Ghana. We're going to take a look at Liberia. and we're going to take a look at Senegal. What's the capital of Iberia?
Monrovia.
Named after President James Monroe. Why? Because Liberia was actually settled by American slaves that were given the chance to go back to their native land and have their own country. Interesting concept. But when you come next week, or the 21st, I'll tell you what happened with that. What happened was that the American slaves enshrined themselves as the new masters over the local black people, building houses that duplicated the plantations from which they had come in the first place. Okay, human nature. There's some very good stories, but that's where we're going next time, West Africa. We've done North, East, South, and then West. We'll finish off on that thing. Now, I can't go through every single one of these countries. You can imagine, this is a jigsaw puzzle down here, all the way from the Congo through Gabon, Cameroon, Nigeria, Togo, Dahomey, Ghana, Ivory Coast, Liberia, Sierra Leone, Guinea, Senegal. Can't do every one of them, but I picked four that would be representative. Do you remember the Ebola outbreak? That was very, very big news in that part of the world, okay? Most of those countries have got it under control now, but what they had to struggle through, they didn't have a CDC. They didn't have the medical facilities we had. Can you imagine what a struggle is to deal with an epidemic like that, of that magnitude, in a country where, you know, the medicine is extremely, very, very primitive? We're talking Band-Aids, you know, as opposed to brain operations. It's a whole different level of technology there. But West Africa is where we're going next. Anything else? Okay, if you liked what you heard today, tell Wendy downstairs, and I'll see you on the 21st. Class dismissed.